there's this little old lady who lives opposite us who always feeds the pigeons very early in the morning. She comes out with her enameled bowl and scatters a great pile of bread all over the gutter. And the pigeons dive down and gobble it up. We thought it would make a nice opening sequence, so we all got up at 6:30. And there we were, standing around, making snowballs, and waiting. And waiting. And the pigeons were waiting. And we were waiting. And every morning the pigeons wait for Miss Bennett to feed them. They sit on her roof up there. They start flying in about 7 o'clock. They've been sitting there for half an hour. They must be frozen. I don't think she's going to feed them today. It's the snow. It's put her off or something. What do you think, Miss? Do you think it's worth going to
waiting? I think we'll have to leave it.
No. Certainly look very cold. They don't rather need some food today, I should have thought. Yeah. In the distance are Oxford's dreaming spires. Although they're so close, some of the college people don't even know Jericho exists, except as a place that servants came from and retired to. It looks like many old working class areas, little two up, two down, terraced houses, front doors on the streets. The big building in the middle distance is the Oxford University Press. In fact, the press, as Jericho people call it, built much of Jericho to house its workers during the last century. The press forms the boundary on that side, together with Worcester College Gardens, all grace and favour lawns, with trees leading down to the canal. The church, right in the middle of the bottom edge of Jericho, is an incredible neo-Ravenna affair. It doesn't really seem to belong to this community, maybe partly because it's in the living of Keble. On the far side of the canal is the station. Lots of railway people used to live in Jericho and come home by ferry across the canal, the second of Jericho's boundaries. There's not much traffic on it. The coal wharf is quite gone, so's the ferry. There's just the pleasure boats now. One of the nice things about living in Jericho is that you can cross the canal by the new footbridge, and in a few minutes you're over the railway line and into Port Meadow in the countryside. You just walk down the towpath opposite the Lucy factory, and you're there. W. Lucy and Company built the factory in 1815. It's a foundry, and many Jericho people worked there through both World Wars. The factory forms the third close boundary to Jericho. It has a strange alien atmosphere, half decayed, echoes from the pasture all around. Perhaps because there's a cemetery right in the very heart. Factory buildings surround the graveyard. The tombstones seem to crowd together inside. The headstones are very grand for Jericho people, but then death used to be much more important in the old days. Those people were honored in death, even though their relations had to go without to afford a proper burial. The foundry bought the cemetery a few years back, so after 100 years or so, it'll all be covered in offices and factory, I suppose. Although from the graveyard that great L-shaped building looks derelict and silent, it's actually the reverse. The company's doing fine. But it doesn't employ so many Jericho people nowadays. A lot of them have died or retired, and their young have moved out to pastures new. That old corner house is owned by the council, but the rest of this street, Jackson Street, is owned by Lucy's. On the left, the garden's back onto the cemetery. It's one of the prettiest streets in Jericho, with gardens in front of the houses. In the distance, that tower belongs to the Radcliffe Hospital, which backs onto Walton Street, Walton Street is the fourth boundary, the one you enter from. A lot of the top part of Jericho there was razed to the ground a few years ago and entirely rebuilt. The threat of all this demolition caused a great outcry. At first, they didn't want those new old people's flats. It's not surprising when you think some people had the houses taken away for just £200 or so. Terrible. Well, the same houses nowadays. You can get £7,000, even when they're in a rundown state. But a lot of the redevelopment's been good. They've kept to the terrace style of housing, and they've rehabilitated a lot of the old houses. Many are under preservation order. But all the same, a lot of the older residents feel Jericho's been ruined. Used to be such a tight-knit community. Now it's full of newcomers. And some of it certainly has died. There used to be a pub on literally every corner. Many have closed, been converted. And a lot of the shops have gone too. Boarded up, their owners moved on, retired. But not some of the tradesmen. There's Mr. Hayworth, the butcher. Now he's doing a thriving business.
Mr. Hayward, you've been trading down in Jericho for many years in the butcher business. Have you seen the pattern of trading change a lot?
Well, it has changed, yes, because obviously in 15 years there's been a vast change in incomes and in and of course in the style of selling meat as well. You know, there have been great changes in the meat trade.
The way they Crichton. It's a bit of a change from here, isn't it?
What do you think of the changes that have taken place in Jericho as a community?
Well, I think they've been very good on the whole. Jericho was a Victorian part of Oxford, and as such had existed for probably about 100 years, and it was, I think, time for change.
How much do you want, Mr. Hayward?
179.
179?
Mm. Also?
Yes, ma'am. I don't like you to make Brian, because you're not serving me. Thank you very much.
All right,
bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
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 I can't stand having all those people staring at me through this peculiar machine. You know, I just get
nervous. What do you want the film to do, Maggie?
I think I want the film really to look like a picture of a community, and partly through our eyes, but partly through the other people's eyes. It's not really trying to say, to wave banners at people. I don't want people around here who do feel strongly about things, for example, about the redevelopment of the school or the squatters. I don't want them to use it as their political platform. And there's a great tendency for people to sort of think, aha, this gives us a chance to say our piece on the BBC, you know. But really want to give a picture, as true a picture as we can, of the community and how it's changing.
How long have you been here?
When I was a court to my husband, he brought me down here. That's would be about 58 years ago.
And do you come to the church every Sunday?
I've been ever since.
Yes?
Yes. He was a boat boy, choir boy. And when I courted him, he carried the cross round.
And you come every Sunday? And you like
when
the service?
When I can, oh, I love it.
You like it?
Yeah, I love the church.
I think 30, 40 years ago must have been the dominating influence in Jericho. I mean, it towers over Jericho. Would you say that's true today?
Rather in a different way, I think. I hope that it has a great it has an influence in Jericho. Of course, in those days, it was very, what one might call an authoritarian influence. It was staffed by a vicar and three priests. Everything was done for the people in that way. But now, of course, it's rather changed, and I think that it has now been necessary to involve the lay people.
Can you tell me a little bit about the history of the church?
Well, it was built about over 100 years ago by a man called Thomas Coombe, who was the founder of the University Press, for the workpeople of the press who lived in these streets, and for the railwaymen who lived here too.
It's an Oxford Movement church, is
it? It is an Oxford Movement church. It was one of the first Tractarian churches in the country.
You've been here 7 years, I think. Of the changes that you've seen, generally speaking, are you pleased or do they distress you?
They certainly don't distress me. I think that the future here is a very exciting future for the people and for the church itself too. Obviously, things can never remain as they are, and although there have been difficulties, I hope very much that one day there will be the unity in the community which we all want.
Tell me about the church.
Oh, how old is it? Over 100 years old, isn't it?
Oh, yes. It was 100 last October.
What about Sundays in those days when you were young?
Oh, well, they were very nice.
Much different then than what they are now. It's like they don't have it.
Did you enjoy church yourselves?
Oh, yes.
Did you enjoy going to church?
Oh, yes.
We looked forward to it Sunday mornings. We used to get up and put on our best clothes, buttoned up shoes, and then they were put away on Monday. and then we went to church in the afternoon, Sunday school, and then the mother would let us, sometimes we went to church Sunday night.
Tell me about what happened after church, when you used to have the Sunday dinner.
We used to go to the bakehouse to fetch the dinner.
To the bakehouse?
Yes.
Where was that?
And they'd have this out, wouldn't they, for a baked potato?
We used to go along to Cannon Street one.
Yes, we generally did. And then after that was closed, we went to Leeds, didn't we?
Yes. We used to have a nice white penny. Nearly always we had a clean one for Sunday, and it was all Guildford and all very pretty. Then we'd wear it Monday morning to school.
And we were all at school at St Barnabas School.
Yes.
At
St Barnabas.
Yes.
We were in the same class. And I had the cane.
Oh, you mustn't tell me.
Yeah. Oh, it was really nice.
All the old people in the neighbourhood came to this school, Mr. Penfold, didn't they? And it's always
yes.
had a reputation of a very happy school. Do you like it here? Do you think it's still a happy school?
Well, since I came at Easter, I've enjoyed it very much here. And it is still a happy school. And in the past, there was certainly a very good community spirit in this area.
Do you think that's still the case?
Well, it's changing. There are still the people who were here a long time ago, and immigrants have moved in, and we're getting people from the universities and the colleges more now, and people who just stay for a short while.
So you've got more of a hodgepodge of children than you used to have?
Well, we have a great variety, yes.
Do they get on well with each other?
Yes, they play together very happily.
Mrs. Braddock, you've been running a campaign about the fact that this school has not been pulled down and the new school hasn't
yes.
been rebuilt.
Yes.
Could you tell me something about that?
Yes, well, as Mr. Penfold says, it is a very happy school, but we're very worried about the physical state of the buildings. I don't know if you can see this iron staircase over here, for instance. The children have to go up and down that every day to get to those classrooms, and in the weather like this, it's very dangerous, it's slippery. You don't really like this school?
Well, I prefer the school to be a bit more modern, but...
Mm-hmm. What's wrong with the building?
Victorian building.
You've
got
the feeling that it's
going to
fall right on top of you.
It's horrible. Well, I don't think it's horrid, but... It's going to be fall down soon.
Well, it might. Yeah. The roof of the junior park fell down once.
Have any of your mothers been at this school before?
Yes, my mum and my nan.
Who wants to move to the new school?
Me! All of us.
Why?
Nicer.
New one.
Yes, yeah, and it's got lots of grass and it has football pitches.
This
and lots of rest.
Well, it's bigger.
Do you like living in Jericho?
Yeah.
Where do you live exactly?
15 Jericho Street. I'm lucky because I live near Port Meadow. Mm-hmm. And I'm only about 5 or 4 minutes walk.
Mr. Graham, you're the secretary of the Residents Association and somebody that everybody knows. What are the sort of things that people come to talk to you about?
Well, everything in general, you know. Domestic, or housing on repairs, new accommodation, when they got into the new accommodation, grumbles or otherwise, you know, sometimes they grumble, sometimes they're very pleased. That is the general thing. Well, everything, domestic and personal.
Yes. And what about the old people who've had to move a lot of them from their old houses and go into council flats? I think there was a lot of reluctance, wasn't there?
Well, it always is with old people, you know. They get used to the bath on Fridays in the kitchen and all this sort of thing. And when they've been told that they have modern bathroom underfloor heating, well, they just don't like to leave their old places, thinking that they may not be able to keep up with the new accommodation. But once they get in, at least everyone that I know, they're really chuffed to bed.
Oh, that's nice. Tell me, I think you have some personal worries about this footbridge.
I'm rather afraid that now we've got the rights of way over the canal and we have the northern spur at the back of the canal, it's still on the planning.
I'm rather worried myself that eventually
we shall have a motorway through Jericho, the same as they have St Ebbs, and it's one of my big worries.
And I think the school, a lot of people are anxious about the site up on the recreation ground.
Well, of course, it's always been our policy, the association policy, that we obliged the council never to turn people out of those until they were due to come down. Well, if they'd have did that, we wouldn't have had the problems that we have now with the school site. This government stopped the building of the new school. There's 2 years, you see, that the place is deteriorating. The whole atmosphere in Jericho is deteriorated because of the empty houses.
Well, there's been a lot of criticism in Jericho, of course. Do you think it's fair?
Well, in all communities, everybody's got something to bitch about, OK? You know, that their old age pensions aren't enough, or their house is leaking or something, you know, or there's a lot of noise, or, you know, and so it comes to squatters. Oh, it's the squatters. It must be the squatters' fault. You know, and they don't realise, I don't think, that they're using us, that they do, some residents do actually believe we're as horrible, you know, as they say we are.
I think that some of the people that came to live here didn't really sort of respect the lives of the people who've been here for 70 years or more, you know, and some people could have been more considerate. But on the other hand, it's taken time for the residents to grow accustomed to us living here and to see that we can be good people to live. For example, we've got a very old lady lives next door to us, and she's very glad to have somebody in the house, you know, because she'd be a bit scared if the house was empty or was just ruined by vandals and, you know, things like that.
What's been your experience?
With the residents?
Yes.
Well, at first, I was a bit suspicious. I thought there was a bad atmosphere here, mainly because there's a Jericho Residents Association meeting, and that got sparks flying. Some of the residents threatened to tear out floorboards and smash the windows in houses that became empty to prevent the squatters moving in. That was before Christmas. But now I find, personally, I'm quite friendly and chat to quite a few of the local residents.
You work down here, don't you?
Yeah.
Can you tell me about your job?
I work for one of the oldest building merchants, you know, in this area. They've all been born around here and they were brought up here, and so just in working for them, you know, in the lorry that I drive, it's got their name on it, so, you know, all the other old residents kind of get to know me like that, you know, so it's okay.
Please, darling.
Are you happy in your house now, Mrs. Robbins?
Yeah, I'm not too bad in there.
Not too bad. It's nice near the pub anyway.
Yes.
You like coming in here for your Guinness?
Yes,
usually.
I come in here for my Guinness.
Yes. You get
I thought you said you want to know about the ferry.
Oh, tell me about the ferry.
Well, I see, my uncle and aunt lived in number 2 at Ferry Road. Well, School Road, as it is. Well, down at the bottom,
was the old ferry, Red's Nose, the old ferry, where the old ferry boat used to go from the ferry over to the canal. And my dad worked on a railway, and he used to come over the old ferry boat and come into my arms, number two. Do you remember that? Fitz, was it?
Fitz. What do you think about your new neighbours, Mrs. Robbins, me and Lucy?
Oh, not too bad, my love.
All right, okay.
What's this?
No, say cheese.
Hello, cheese.
Have some more tea, Clay.
Usually, busy.
Yes, I did.
Marie, isn't it with you?
Yeah.
Me, Mum and Dad and Tricia.
You didn't. Mum and Dad and Tricia did.
Yeah, and I was born in Granny's, wasn't I? Mm.
Where's Granny's, Clive?
78. Yeah, she used to live at 17 up the top, you know, number 17.
Oh,
it's been pulled down, you know, being pulled down, isn't it?
Yeah. Tell us a bit about how the old community was. Was it very closely knit?
Oh, yes. Well, everywhere, really. But, you know, if anyone were a family in trouble, like someone would take the kids off, someone else would take the washing, someone else would do cooking, you know.
Do you think maybe people like me and Maggie will settle down here and have our families and then maybe our generation?
Well, yes, you should do, but then again, it'll be, it wouldn't be our sort of life, it would be your sort of life, wouldn't it?
Her own family's been here how long, from Jericho?
Oh, my mother was 20, and she married, she moved into Jericho. Now she's nearly 81.
Does she regret the old days?
Yes. Yeah. Nobody's the same. The old Jericho's gone.
Can you tell me about the cemetery? You said some of your relations were buried there.
My mother, my father are buried there. My grandmother, and I think my grandfather.
Do you think there's a lot of Jericho people buried there?
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Quite a lot.
Would you like it as a visual place?
Yes, all I like is a visual place. I mean, I can see that some people would think that, you know, well, what's all this? You know, it's just sort of any place like anywhere else. But it's pretty. It's very pretty, too, in a sort of working class way. I suppose in the quaint kind of way that middle class people like me think this sort of place is pretty, artisan cottages and so on.
Are you regretting the change? I mean, what do you think?
No, I didn't regret the change.
Part of the...
Well, I didn't regret the change because, I mean, the change, I'm part of the change. I can't regret the change.
Your Oxford University students living in Jericho, tell us how you feel about the way people react to you and how you like it here.
I've been living here 3 years and now I'm going to the pub. I really know quite a lot of people, which is quite nice. The people here are very kindly disposed towards students when you consider that the students have been a factor which in a way has probably made life worse for them in that it's made the housing here less readily available for them. I blame largely the university, which has done absolutely nothing to cater for its expanding student population.
How do you find people treat you in such a community as an immigrant and also a university student?
No particular sort of way of treating me. I don't think that there's any special kudos attaches to being one of the darker skinned races. Well, not in Jericho, anyway.
Mr. Pan, it's rather a unique kind of shop, this. Can you tell me how you started it and why you sell the things you do?
Actually, it was established by my father in 1966. And I joined him a year later. I was inclined in some business.
This is Jericho. It's a mixture, really, entirely of old and young couples, new people like myself, and other sorts of people, all sorts of people, immigrants. I live down Cardigan Street. I found Jericho one evening when I was returning from the station. I shared a taxi with a guy who got off the train with me, and we ended up in one of these streets, I think somewhere over there, and he got out, and I looked around me, and I thought, boy, I'm going to live here.
You felt the same way about it, didn't you?
Yes, I loved it.
God's sake.
Hello, dear.
All these flowers
right here,
then.
Oh, dear, come
here.
Drop your
look. Eh? Drop your look. Ah, lovely nose.
Have you got the key?
Oh, well, I've got some on the back of the door. Everyone will know how to get in our
Where do you reckon you fit into Jericho community?
Well, I think that it's such a mixed bag of people here. There's the established older community, and there's the younger people that have moved in, and there are people like ourselves, which you don't get on a normal modern housing estate where people are moving in and starting off all together.
What do you value most about living in Jericho?
Well, different things. From a job point of view, of course, it's very convenient. I work at the Ashburnham Museum, and Jennifer used to work at the Radcliffe, and so it's only 4 or 5 minutes away, either on the bicycle or on foot. And that's immensely valuable when one's spent the last 5 years or so commuting in endless traffic jams. We also value the fact that we can find in the centre of Oxford a small house and a small garden, which doesn't require a lot of work to keep up, but is very cosy and in very nice surroundings, with nice people next door and opposite and so on.
What are the sort of the bits of the neighbourhood that you visit or take part in?
Well, the place that we always seem to end up in is the Carpenter's Arms, led mainly by James because of the beer, because it's off the wood.
One pint. Right. There we go, then.
It doesn't matter who it is, a complete stranger. Once they come into the door, they're in amongst us. Oh, and we accept them as like a family. And the whole atmosphere is family-wise, and nobody is left out in the cold.
Cheers, mate.
Oh, I've never known this pub orders. What's happening? Yeah. Good part they used to years ago. I was spitting a little years and years ago. I think 28 years ago, but apart from that, it's never altered, has it? Not a dime in coming.
No, I mean, Jericho itself, I mean, neighbours were really neighbours. There's no doubt about it.
We have a good old laugh and a joke. If I say something to Cecil now, he'd pick me up immediately because he'd know what I meant, but the others wouldn't. I said, well, it's clannish if you put it that way. But we totally enjoy it, anyway. And the beer, of course.
People here have been really fabulous.
It was really nice, happy days.
You had some happy times and that, and bad times.
Monsieur,
I see you're wasting time. Yes, okay, stop it.
All the best.